It's an excellent evening as far as I am concerned because we have NSC and BSC talking to you together. They oversee the listing compliances and corporate governance compliances of about more than 5,000 companies in the country. In fact, they are the pallbearers of the corporate governance movement in this country. I'm sure that most of you are aware that there are two broad structures of making regulations for any kind of a regulatory area. Either it should be principle based or should be rule based. This is the argument that is going on for quite some time. Up to 2005 or so, 2005-6, they thought that rule based is good. Between 2005 and 2012, the situation was we'll go more by principle based because we expect the regulated entities to be more matured and therefore principle should be there. Outcome will be examined. On the basis of outcome, we'll judge whether a particular activity done by a regulated entity is actionable or not. But 2012 onwards, there's a clear-cut departure from both these structures. They brought in what is called as a hybrid structure, wherein they talk both of principles and rules. This is necessary because where you've got a principle-based regulatory structure, people who could talk into the ears of regulators, they could convince the regulator that what they did is right. And people who could not reach the ears of the regulators, they were questioned and there is a lot of questions about it. Whereas rule-based was too strict in the sense that if the regulator misses a particular point to be mentioned in the rule book, the person, the regulated entities will escape, take an escape route and get away from that and say, you did not mention, therefore I did not comply. In order to see that these two situations are handled well, a hybrid structure is brought in. And I would say that listing regulations that we have today is an excellent piece of hybrid regulatory structure. And probably in India, we are one of the luckiest countries in terms of having a abundant clarity about what does the regulator want and what should be the regulatory framework for corporate governance as such. Chapter 2 of the listing regulations enunciates principles of corporate governance. And whereas other parts of the regulation, other chapters of the listing regulations deal with the rules of corporate governance and compliance requirements under the listing regulation. If somebody reads this book, actually I myself, when I read it for the first time, I made a joke with my colleagues saying that, oh, it has been written by some MBA final year student in terms of winning a essay writing competition. That's how it looked like. It's not legalistic at all. Clearly mentioning what exactly the regulator wants. It's a lovely piece of document. It has been developed on the OECD principles and generally recognized principles of corporate governance. If you read Section 2, Companies Act 2013 and risk regulations together, there's abundant clarity on how should a corporate governance look like. Any independent director should not have any kind of a confusion whatsoever in terms of what his roles, responsibilities are as far as corporate governance is concerned. That way, we are lucky. Many countries are still struggling in terms of pinning down and say, hey, my director, it's your responsibility. Whereas in our country, there's an abundant clarity. The objective of our discussions today will be to explore this this structure and bring you all the nuances of these regulations very clearly. Before I hand, they take it over to the panel of discussion, I want to make one more observation. We had a regime called listing agreement before listing regulations came into force in 2015. The listing agreement regime was actually a bilateral agreement between the stock exchange and the listed company. And if the company does not comply with, it was necessary for a stock exchange to follow the route of civil courts to be able to take a compliance action. Of course, SEBI had some kind of a padding action. They gave some powers, etc., but it was not sufficient. In order to see that this difficulty is mitigated and compliance is very squarely put on the listed companies and somebody also enforces it. Again, this is a beautiful part of Indian regulation. Unlike other countries, enforcement of corporate governance framework has been entrusted to the stock exchanges. Each stock exchange that is represented here has more than 70-80 people working on monitoring the corporate governance compliances of the various listed companies. They keep on monitoring, they raise questions, they see that, they guide the companies to see that they are well on track as far as corporate governance is concerned. And that way, India, I think, is far ahead in terms of corporate governance framework is concerned. I mean, we should be proud about it. With these opening remarks, I would like to, the format I have is like this. I have a selected list of questions, which I'll be posing to one of the panelists. Depending upon whoever wants to answer, that's fine for me. Or I can name the panelist who wants to answer this question. Anyway, I will start with both the panelists as the first question is concerned. My question to both panelists is, in your experience and observation, do you think corporate India is by and large compliant with the listing regulations, or is there a need or a scope for improvement? What is your observation? Mr. Neeraj. You are muted. Hello. I will invite you to pass your initial remarks and then they take the question. Similarly, Ms. Priya also, please give your initial remarks, then come to the question. Mr. Neeraj, please.
So, thank you, Dr. Narasimhan. I think I also thank this IICA NISM initiative for providing me this opportunity to speak here. I think it's a very eminent gathering, as I can see. So, sir, I think your opening remarks are very instructive and very, very appropriate because, you know, and you correctly, I think, brought out how the sequence of the transition that took place in terms of all these guidelines. See, the broad theme from our perspective, if we see corporate governance has been one of the biggest focus areas for the regulator SEBI. And understanding that context, I think it has been important that how do you then make corporates responsible for that? So in fact, you know, if we see conceptually, SEBI has created a framework where they set up a committee, and I mean, I'm referring to the Kotak committee in a sense, but which has corporates along with all the various market participants, and then everyone discusses and decides, and then based on that, these kind of frameworks are finally formed and which then translate into the listing agreement. The underlying theme or the overarching theme was always that corporate governance has to be strong and in terms of compliance, and this all that the listing agreement does is translates that into some kind of reporting by corporates. And yes, you are right that there is quite some prescriptiveness in terms of these regulations. But having said that, there is also the other side, which is about information, equal access to information and transparency for investors. And by and large, what we have seen, just one more important point is that the regulator has been mindful of, you know, the companies, the small companies, and so it's been a gradual process, like first top 500, then the next 500 again, and then the next 500,000, whatever. So that's been the broad strategy. To essentially it's a nudge, but the nudge eventually will result in overall action. And by and large, our experience, when we have seen that majority of the companies to whom all the regulations have been applicable to are largely compliant. When I say largely compliant, what I mean is around 90%. So that's the big positive theme. And there are, I'll stop here for the moment because I think Priya may also like to speak something. So over to you.
Yeah, Ms. Priya. Hello. Ms. Priya.
Yeah, sorry, I have a problem unmuting myself. For some reason, it's in.
We can hear you.
Okay. I'm just going to. Right, Dr. Narasimhan?
Yeah, we are able to hear you. Yeah.
So I just want to obviously start with thanking both you and Dr. Tarashankar for this opportunity. We do want to interact with our companies and at every venue and opportunity that we get. So, and this, frankly, I think I'm seeing almost 200 directors who have been able to join us. So I think that that's great attendance for today. To take off from where you left, one is the regulator is doing this in a more phased manner, just so to be able to get appropriate buy-in, I think, from the companies when as and when they increase the standards of governance. Broadly, what do we find? I mean, NSE has got 2,000 odd companies. And what we are broadly finding from a form perspective, at least, is that there's been anywhere between 93 to 95% compliance. And that we saw even within the COVID period. So it's not, so I think by and large, there's very clearly a realization that corporate governance is extremely important. And the fact that, not filing a form, not doing something is not frankly going to cut it. Exchanges are watching, regulators watching, and therefore we are seeing that level of compliance. The other point that I would say, I'm sure Dr. Narasimhan, you have many questions on form and substance, which you're going to grill us on. But before that, just keeping that aside for a minute. I think the markets almost always have recognized governance per se. You would see that whether or anything else, there is one company, even if you were to assume that the asset sizes are somewhat similar, you would find one company getting better valuation than another company. And much more, much more marquee investor names coming into that company. I think we've seen many examples in the past too. We see examples even today. Market recognizes and rewards governance, I think, higher levels of governance. And therefore, one is the regulator push to get India to the spot that we all need to be in. The second is markets. Markets have always done that. So that would be, I think, there is enough of a push factor and a pull factor is what I would say from a governance perspective. I will stop here and, allow Neeraj and me to be grilled by you, sir.
No, purpose is to elicit information for our participants. It's very heartening to note that more than 90% companies are compliant. 95%, as Priya was saying, 95% of the companies are compliant with the corporate governance framework. That's an excellent news. And the balance of 5%, I don't know why they are not able to come. I think through the course of the discussion, we'll get to know why they are not actually being compliant. Another important point, Priya, you made is that about market also will try to push them in terms of being compliant for their valuation purposes. A simple commercial requirement also makes them to be more compliant. Actually, Neeraj also has made an excellent point in terms of how these recent compliances are being regularly introduced in a phased manner, in a way that the compliance is not a burdensome activity, but it's more a pleasant, and then on the basis of learning that we have, is being getting extended. Excellent. But I want to know, when you talk about compliance, is it all about quarterly report that they comply, file with you, which you monitor and say they are compliant, or you have any other mechanism to monitor the corporate governance standards of the companies on a regular and ongoing basis? Priya.
May I come in, sir? Tarashankar here, sir.
Please.
I would like to announce that please switch off, except speakers, others I'm requesting to switch off their camera, because this is creating a bandwidth issues. So there's a humble request if you can switch off your cameras. So the voice clarity would be far better. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Tarash. Thank you. So I would like to come back to the same question again. I was asking a question whether the stock exchanges have any other means to monitor corporate governance standards of these companies, or do they look at corporate governance only through the quarterly report that the companies file with them? What is the mechanism exactly in place? Priya. Hello. Ms. Priya? Okay. By the time Ms. Priya comes in, I think Mr. Neeraj, if you could answer the question, please.
Sure. So let us understand. We see the filings. So filings are actually at different intervals. So that's, of course, one of good source of information for us. But in addition, there are several other mechanisms that we use. For example, print media or digital media. So digital media has also become important. Social media has also become important. So, the real point, what are we trying to say? Information asymmetry is removed so that an investor can take an informed decision with respect to their investment decisions. So, and on the other side, there is an obligation on the companies to provide material information in a timely manner as per the regulation 30 to the stock exchanges. So this is an important area which we of course cannot only leave to the quarterly checking, but it is in fact every day media sources are scanned and these aspects are certainly looked at with respect to that, and where required explanation is also sought from the companies. And not only that, besides the explanation, we also ensure that all this information is posted on the exchange's website so that it's not only the exchange but everyone can see what's happening. Besides that, so this is certainly one of the major aspects that we keep monitoring. Besides that, we also work closely with SEBI. So our surveillance teams are regularly in touch with SEBI and with respect to various aspects. In case, you know, there are violations, or, you know, we do investigative, you know, there are in general, I mean, not necessarily with surveillance, but in general, if there are any other, any types of violations, etc. And we also provide reports to SEBI on a case-by-case basis. And finally, and there is very detailed monitoring going on along with other MIs also, like things like shareholding pattern, or in terms of corporate governance, you know, if there are any specific issues. So, as I said, it's event-based. It's also based on the regular filing. And over and above that, there is this daily monitoring, which is also being done. So if that answers the question, sir.
Yeah. Apriya, your view on this, please. My question was, do you monitor the corporate governances only through the quarterly report they file, or do you have any other mechanism over and above that?
Things quarterly filings, yes. So we are obviously whenever there's a shareholding pattern filing, etc., we are seeing whether, you know, last quarter and this quarter, if there's a change, what is the change, so on and so forth. But more importantly, a bulk of what we do also comes in from two other sources. One is announcements. You know, as Neeraj will tell you, and we receive a few hundred announcements on a daily basis. So clearly, all of us have had to, the exchanges have had to develop a mechanism where we are able to look at these announcements. First is there's a SEBI regulation around adequacy and accuracy of announcements. But more importantly, we've had to develop an internal mechanism through which we are able to look at announcements in a little different way. So if I were to give you two or three examples, say for a few, I think about a couple of months ago, there was a company which actually said that they have entered into an agreement with somebody else as a share subscription agreement. And so the acquisition of X percent was supposed to happen within, you know, X date. So the reason why I go into granularity is to actually come back with to sort of inform the audience about the granularity with which we are doing this. So we were actually monitoring that particular date along with the company, I'm sure. We were also monitoring that date. When that acquisition did not happen within that date, we actually went back to them and said, all right, you had said you will complete within this date. We've been monitoring this. So, you know, now what next? Because clearly that this is a material one. So quarterly disclosure is just a very small part of what we do. A larger part is also coming from, as I just said, announcements we monitor very closely, actually. We can give you another example. There was one person against whom there was some kind of order. It was more to do with environmental, etc. And a particular plant of that entity was supposed to be shut. So because of that particular order. Now, that disclosure was not made to us. We actually, so they made the disclosure without necessarily saying, you know, what was the plant, how material it was, and so on and so forth. So we actually followed up and tried to find out, ki baba, ye factory band ho gaya toh, how big is this? Turns out that that particular factory ends up producing a majority of the product, which clearly from a materiality perspective is extremely important. So therefore, those are the kind of things that we do. Thirdly, I think if members are not aware, SEBI has actually come back with a new department called CFID, which is Corporate Finance Investigation Department. So under the aegis of that department, there'll be a lot more work that we will do with regard to disclosures by the company, the balance sheets of the company, so on and so forth. So not just the quarterly disclosures, much more than that.
Oh, I think a lot of things have come up now for understanding what this compliance business is all about. I mean, corporate governance business is all about. Priya made use certain words called announcements, and she talked about adequacy and accuracy. I think these three are fairly loaded words, I believe. I think I should talk 1 or 2 minutes about on this, because announcement, what exactly it means is, I think under Regulation 30 of the listed LODR, every company is supposed to make disclosures. Those disclosures are called announcements from the point of view of stock exchanges. And the announcement that the companies made are checked. Priya has just given an example saying that somebody announces acquisition by so-and-so date and it doesn't happen. It's actually rated, taken, monitored, questioned, and correspondence goes on between the company and the stock exchange. That's a beautiful point. That is, both NSE and BSE are alert. They are continuously monitoring whether whatever has been said by the company are being actually strictly implemented or not, and whether the company is saying what press is trying to say about that company, and so on and so forth. I think definitely companies are put on some kind of a notice on this. The next question that comes up is that, why should this disclosure be made at all in the first place? Do you think that the companies don't believe these disclosures have anything to do with the investor's decisions for making or buying, hold or sell the company stock? Why do you think regulation has to say that make the disclosures? Is it really necessary? Don't companies know all this? Neeraj.
So you're right. See, that's the point of prescriptive sense. Now, somehow what happens is, when regulations are made, the debate would always be that, whether there should be self-regulation, and so there need not be any prescription, or that, let us provide. So in a sense, these are the minimum standards. And believe me, whatever is reported, we know of companies who are, in fact, exceed the standards. So, and finally, as exchanges, we are in the business of trust. And a key element of creating the trust is removing the information asymmetry, so that no one has more information or less information than any other person. And the objective of SEBI is also to ensure fair and orderly market with respect to information asymmetry, etc. So this assurance is very much required, because otherwise investors will lose their confidence in terms of the fairness of markets. And therefore, timely disclosure is a must-have. Now, the prescriptiveness only arises because, as an exchange, we can tell you. For example, we have created an online system for filing of, as was mentioned about any major announcement that the company has to do. They can disseminate that. Now, from the stage that the company official presses enter, there is no human intervention at the exchange side. It directly goes, because there were possible, people said that, what if, some exchange official is delay some information, etc. So we said we will not get involved in that. So it directly goes onto the website. And similarly, so and the other piece is that, yes, you have, while a lot of companies may complain or say that, these are very prescriptive, these are very detailed, et cetera, but to a large majority of companies, these help also, because it helps. So the way we help them is we, in fact, provide them reminders that, this report is pending for this quarter, et cetera, et cetera. And plus we keep talking to the companies, et cetera, et cetera. So it is a big, it is a positive, I think, from that perspective. And what if, even if it is, people feel it's prescriptive, finally, it's the investor who's the end point to all this information. And if this helps the investor, why not? I'll stop here.
Yeah. Priya, your reactions?
See, for one is, yes, it could be the fact that some of these rules are very prescriptive. Fact remains that when something is clearly set out, the good companies, as we always know, from a governance perspective, the good companies will always comply, rule or no rule. they will go, you know, they have investors whom they care about, and therefore will give adequate information. But equally, you know, what is adequate to one person may not necessarily be adequate to the other person. Therefore, if at all investors need to make a comparison between one company and the other, there needs to be a base level of information which should come in. That's the first thing. Secondly, from a consistency perspective also. So, you know, base level and consistent level of information. So one time you give certain information, the next quarter you don't give that information. Comparability, assessment, everything gets a lot more difficult. So while we are still, you know, even if we were to assume that at this point, as you said, you know, Dr. Narasimhan, that we are having a good mix of principle-based and role-based. Let's assume for a minute we go into principle-based 100% 10 years from now. I don't know if it will happen, but if it does, even then I think we will require a base level of minimum requirement, so to speak, where disclosures need to be made. Of course, you know, in certain other questions, I'm reasonably sure I will get a chance to talk about information overload. But be that as it may, I think base level of information for the purposes of comparability and consistency, I think is extremely important. The other thing is, if we were to leave it to the company, one thing that most companies might use as a yardstick is materiality. But what's material for one person will almost never be material for the other person. Therefore, if we were to simply leave it to the company, again, from a board perspective, if I were to put myself in the board shoes, potentially boards would prefer to err on the side of caution. Therefore, we will end up with a lot more information which might not necessarily be useful for the investor. So I think for all concerned, it might be the best thing to have that, to have a particular structure and certain parameters for disclosures. That's clear, my clear view. One other thing that we have found, again, if I were to sort of go back to examples, you know, one would have imagined that if you're talking about an independent director's resignation, etc., you would actually say, and that person is saying that these are the four reasons for which I have resigned, you would actually put it out in the public domain. Either there's a rule which says you put it out or you don't put it out. The issue that we had in one of the situations is the company decided to actually put out two of the four reasons. You know, so you get these kind of examples too, which sort of leads me to believe that you'll perhaps rule based for some time, and a lot more rigor might be the prescription for the next few years.
That's an excellent way of looking at it. That is, you need to nudge the people to make disclosures, and there should be some standard structure in which should be disclosed, because people are generally shy in giving at least negative news, is what I think. I understand from what you both have said. Now the question comes up is, we are now amidst the independent directors of various companies. All companies under the Companies Act and the listed regulations have appointed the key managerial personnel. Key managerial personnel are professionals paid for making disclosures, making compliance, etc. But often we find regulators question the directors, saying that, what are you doing? Even KMPs have been appointed for these compliance purposes. Do you think directors have any role in these disclosures? Because one of the requirements under the LODR is that board should oversee the disclosures made. So is it necessary that board should be actually overseeing this issue at all? That's a question for me. Neeraj.
Yeah, sure. So the compliance officer or KMP or any official of the company, I mean, whatever name be called, finally, there is a responsibility from a management to fulfill certain obligations, etc. That will always remain. However, I mean, eventually, why are boards, what is the importance of boards? I mean, organization philosophies or ethos on disclosures, etc. I mean, these are principles which are essentially board driven. And they are responsible for creating that kind of environment whereby the company ensures. So the governance from the board, in fact, ensures better compliance, because the management will certainly be put on the on their toes to ensure that the disclosure requirements are correctly being met. So I mean, the role of the board and the board of directors is certainly a very, very important framework in this whole ecosystem, because without that board direction, companies, and as Priya said, you know, what is material for one may not be material for others, but the moment there is a responsibility of the board to get involved, at that stage, what happens is, we have certainly seen that, you know, proactive boards, in fact, they approach us many times as exchanges. They approach us, they ask us questions, at least some of the directors would ask us specific questions as to how this thing can happen, that can happen, and plus we of course, these kind of events we go to. So I think it's a big, big positive, and gradually, if you see the importance of the boards, from an enforcement angle also has become very important from the enforcement authority. So therefore, well, that's a very large debate. To the limited point here, it's more the philosophy and the ethos, which is what facilitates the companies to ensure proper disclosures.
Priya, your views?
Yeah, my views are pretty much the same that Neeraj has said. Tone from the top is extremely important. You know, any well-governed company will necessarily have a very strong voice at the top, which sort of nudges and pushes the company towards governance levels. But at the end of the day, I'm thinking about it from the director's side. If I'm going to be held responsible, and I, you know, for the governance of a company, and as it and the board is at the topmost of that pyramid, it would be important for me to also make sure that the right disclosures are made, the right message goes out into the market, to the investors, to everybody else. So, to the extent that, while, you know, I don't think the expectation of the exchanges is that every single piece of paper people would look at, but the fact remains that diligence, I think, is important from the boards as well. Not just to give a broader direction, but also, you know, make sure that the right level of disclosures are made and properly. I mean, I think the point which you're really trying to ask is, you know, there's too much of nitty gritty. Perhaps, I mean, I would not necessarily, you know, provide my judgment here, but the board is in a different way. It's a trustee, right? If I'm a trustee of something, I have to make sure that my obligation is correctly met. And to that extent, if I have to, I would actually go back to something that Regan said, trust but verify. So if I were to go back to that analogy, some level of verification from the board is not wrong for the protection of the company, for the protection of themselves also.
If I can ask a supplementary on this, do you think that KMPs do not enjoy the adequate amount of freedom, and they are a little worried about questioning from the board for making, I would say, the full disclosures or disclose the way in which they have couched the disclosures? Is that a worry between amongst the KMPs, due to which board has to make its views clear to them and then give them enough freedom and empower them to make disclosures? Is it what you are saying?
Sorry, are you saying that the KMPs would feel that they don't have enough freedom? I mean, can you just...
Is the question. Is there where, that's where boards have some additional role to play in terms of empowering them and giving them adequate freedom to make disclosures?
See, I don't necessarily think it is lack of freedom, honestly. I don't think that's the case. I mean, Neeraj can tell you, and I can tell you that we are both KMPs and we have a regulatory oversight committee at the exchanges, which is slightly broader, all independent and slightly broader from perspective. But so therefore, I don't think it is a fact that management doesn't necessarily allow KMPs to make the right disclosures, and therefore the boards and independent directors have to step in. But I think, frankly, when a board actually gives you its mindset in terms of how seriously it would take you know, disclosures, proper level of compliance disclosures, not just for the purpose of disclosures, but proper disclosures, I think it sends a good message, not just to the KMPs, but across the company. I think that's extremely important. What the messages that a board gives gets transmitted, to my mind, across the KMPs and the senior management, and then filters down to the company as well. because it's exceedingly difficult. I mean, it's impossible, I would say, for the board or even the senior management to look at every single thing that happens in a company. But if the company and everybody else in it actually realizes that there is going to be no tolerance for anything which is incorrect, that I think is the best possible messaging that a board can do. So to that extent, it's not just, you know, it's not really a conflict between the KMPs and the management. I think it's just a question of messaging and appropriate messaging.
Okay, fine. There's a question from the participants, and also I have a question on the same thing. Every quarter, lots of financial disclosures and other disclosures are made. Are these disclosures are covering all the interests of all stakeholders or not? And what do the exchanges do with these disclosures? What do they check in these disclosures? There's a lot of information coming into stock exchanges. Do you simply file them? Do you look at something in that? What exactly is happening with these disclosures? Can you please elaborate on the processes that you adapt in this?
So Neeraj, you want to take that? I will also state my piece.
Sure. So if you see the framework, I mean, you know, it rightly starts from the framework that the filings are done in a format like XBRL format, for example, which ensures basic checks and which also ensures interoperability in the sense, you know, it can be easily taken by anyone for analysis, etc., etc. But more than that, exchanges use this data for the purpose of, first is we compare with the submissions done earlier. And if there are deviations, there are clearly alerts which are generated. And post that, I mean, we want to also explain that if companies have not complied with certain regulations, etc., there's a very, very strict framework which includes penalties, then moves on to various stages. You know, it's a very graded action, but which moves on to the stage of eventually very, very severe actions against companies. And this is done on a quarterly basis. So this is just one part. The other part is, as you know, we have also explained, you know, we do question companies. Because see, these are essentially from the filing perspective, if there is some other additional aspect which has come about. But on a day-to-day basis, you know, typically where if the companies have not filed, the kind of questioning that takes place. And also, I think one of the points we probably did not mention is both exchanges coordinate on this. So our teams know each other, we talk to each other on a very regular basis to ensure that there is no regulatory arbitrage that anyone can do with respect to the action that we initiate against companies. So, you know, that's the kind of framework that we are in.
Let's stop here.
Yeah, so essentially, as Neeraj said, we don't just file it. We, in fact, do a lot of work around it. And we have built, actually, we have built some, and we are in the process of building more, you know, automated solutions to try and, so just for example, I think I mentioned this earlier as well. So if there's a shareholder difference, then, and suddenly there's a change, we would obviously go back and check. So, and some of the examples can be quite funny, but be that as it may, we actually go and check, okay, 10 people were promoters the last quarter, how many people are promoters now? Is it the same thing? Is it different? And if somebody has now become the promoter, or if they've increased their stake, for example, have the, you know, there's a disclosure to be made under insider dealing guidelines as well. So have the right disclosures been made in the interim? So we are checking for disclosures. We are checking. We also check, for example, you know, segment reporting and so on from a financial perspective. The third, which I'd really like to say, is this is the first year, 2020 is the first year we received, you know, our annual report also in XBRL. So we are also trying to build comparability around that to actually check whether there are sharp differences and if there are things that should worry us. So if there are fundamentally sharp differences and peer group, for example, has not shown the same difference, then potentially it could be a flag for us to probe further. Therefore, those are the kind of things that we are building. We are in the process of doing so. I will not deny that for a long time. Our job was to actually make sure that people filed that report, not so much what was in that report. So, you know, we have, again, regulations per se are always an evolving process. Therefore, the first stage was really to make sure people took things seriously, filed the right report. Now the next job is to see what is in that report, and is that, and obviously analysis of that, to actually see if there's a difference. If there's a difference, why is there a difference? We have ended up finding that in certain situations, somebody was shown as executive director in one quarter or one half year. Next quarter, they have become non-executive.
Wow.
Somebody has been independent, have become now something else. So, you know, and there was one letter, frankly, I was very amused. They have said that we have reported as not executive, but please treat it as non-executive. I mean, I'm not joking. We actually received a letter which said this. So, sometimes the regulatory department also requires some amount of humor in our lives. It's not all. So we have some fun sometimes. But to answer the question very clearly, we are moving towards much more analysis of what is reported to us. I think you will see a significant amount of change in the next year, 18 months, etc. We are trying to put automated solutions, automated alerts, not just to see whether somebody's reported, but also last quarter, we are trying to do trend analysis. You will see quite a few things coming out in the next year and a half.
If I understand you both correctly, what you're saying is these quarterly filings are the windows through which you peep into the standards of corporate governance in these companies. Very well said. Neeraj, there's a question to you saying that you have said that you are, these heavy penalties are levied, etc. Can you recall any example where some companies were heavily penalized because of non-compliances or not under LODR? Are there any penalties levied? Can you recall any examples?
No, there are. So, you know, it starts with the simple things like, you know, for example, appointment of women director or minimum public shareholding or things like board composition not being met, committee composition not being met, etc. So there are, all this has to be done within stipulated timelines and in which actions are initiated by us. Of course, I have my colleague also on here who can give you the specific instances. But having said, the principle is very important. And I can tell you off late recently what happened during COVID. In fact, if you may recall, there were specific exemptions which were provided by SEBI, which permitted at least understanding the situation at that point of time where there was these lockdowns, etc. SEBI also exempted companies from several of these reportings, etc. But the point that we are trying to make is that the framework is such that it may start with a simple thing like, you know, companies not, in fact, every quarter we get so many requests for waiver. And if I recall, the approximate number that I get every quarter, in fact, we were just analyzing a few days back, is around between 1000 to 1200 waiver requests from companies.
Waiver of penalty, that is, you must have levied 1,200 penalties and they're asking for waiver.
Interesting. And these are each regulation specific. So, see, finally, the list of companies may be around 500, 600 in that. But I'm saying that's the kind of framework we have. So, they also understand. Because for us, the levying of penalty, because things are automated, I just term it as a mechanical action. In the sense, this is not complied straight away. Technology helps us find out and we just shoot out and we are very clear. Then, of course, companies then come back, they represent. There is a framework of SEBI which exempts some of these, but not the others. There are some exemptions which are must do. So then they have no choice. And because of this, this kind of monitoring, companies also ensure that at least the basic framework, and what are we talking about finally? Finally, we are talking about this as the basic framework from a corporate governance perspective. That has to be met. I mean, companies, of course, and the good companies have been exceeding that.
I have a supplementary to Priya. This is coming from audience now. What you're asking is, you are observing, you have got some observations made, etc. But this is not consumption. This is not for the consumption of regulator alone. It should go to the stakeholder concern, at least shareholders concern. When you find some red flags in the non-compliances or anything of that sort, do you anyway communicate this to the shareholders? If so, what is your mechanism?
Actually, we don't directly at this point of time communicate. There have been reports and things that we have, certain initiatives that we have taken in the past. Where, for example, if there is a 8 quarters losses, for example, and shareholders are still there, we used to send it through depositories, you know, message to the shareholders. But some of these red flags, we don't necessarily you know, we don't necessarily immediately tell the shareholders. The point is, there are, as Neeraj said, there are certain things which are covered under what we call the SOP, standard operating procedures, for certain parts of the LODR. And the point being that those are well defined, and it's more a binary. It's a zero or one. Either you have complied or not complied. Some of these things are not binary. These are things which we have observed. There could be reasons for which, you know, why there are these differences. If we were to sort of shoot out and tell the shareholders XYZ, then, you know, we would probably not be doing justice to the company, because perhaps there are reasons. And I think, you are aware, sir, and many of the people will be aware. We don't necessarily have, at this point of time, the authority that exchanges have over the over companies is under specific sections. Unlike where an exchange, you know, what it would do to a broker, which is registered with it on the secondary market side, we would inspect the broker, we would go deep into the office, get information. We don't have at this point of time. It would be intemperate of us to actually just shoot out something to the shareholders, which is why we actually tell SEBI that these are what we have found. If you want to take more steps, you know, you could potentially look at all of these things and then ask an explanation of the company, and then come up with an order or a warning or a direction, etc. So that's the reason why we don't do it. But potentially, maybe in the future, I don't know. But that's the way things stand as of now.
Neeraj, you were talking about information asymmetry. I have read one interesting circular issued by SEBI in May, saying that for a COVID purpose, you have to make so many disclosures. I've seen SEBI issuing several circulars defining the nitty-gritties of what disclosures have to be made for each type of event that's happening in the company. Do you think it is too minute, too granular, too interfering, and then it's an overdose of compliance? Was it necessary? What's your experience and observation about this?
So, sir, I'll tell you what it was driven by was let's understand, you know, there was this COVID situation which was being faced in this country. And stock markets were one of the key institutions which continued to operate throughout the period. And trading is taking place, but information with respect to, and you know, from the way the lockdown has happened, the information wise, we felt at that point of time, it was felt that at least the basic minimum, every investor, you know, while the actual information would come at the end of the quarter, but there is some basic information with respect to the impact of COVID on the corporates, which it was felt, and rightly so, that that also should be a part of a special disclosure. I mean, in the absence of any better word, I'll call it a special disclosure, just to facilitate, I mean, finally, just to remove that information asymmetry angle. So it's purely driven from the interest of the investors, because trading is taking place. Investors may or may not know how each company on which, you know, they are purchasing or selling or taking some investment decisions. So in that context only, this has been done, sir.
Yeah, your views, Priya, on this? I mean, is it necessary that regulator should prescribe so minutely on this?
See, honestly, again, to go back to Neeraj's point, you know, and I think we spoke about this earlier as well. There needs to be some level of consistency, some level of comparability. We will not be able to get to a point of without that level of consistency. And we're really talking about base minimum, right? We are not necessarily stopping anybody from giving more information. Sometimes there is an information overload. And just yesterday, we were in a CII meeting, and somebody said that a corporate, which has quite a few group companies, had actually made its filing. And if you print the filing, that would have been about 2 feet. So nobody stops anybody from giving. But at the same time, if we have to progress again, we spoke about the fact that, corporate governance and governance over companies is really evolving. But if we need to get to a point, and in the course of that evolution, there will be stages where some things might be looking too prescriptive. But be that as it may, just for the sake of getting information out to the investors, I think it's important that that some level of, you know, there is a base minimum. I don't honestly believe at this stage we are at a stage where, except for certain companies, the level of disclosures is so much that, again, disclosures so much that it is unwarranted. I don't believe that. Some companies over disclose in any case, and therefore the question is not really for them. My colleague points out to me that all non-compliances are actually available on our website. This may not be exception reports that we do, but these are really for non-compliances. It's available on BSE website and on NSE website. So therefore, people can, you know, investors can go and see the website for routine. Where we actually find the exception reports, we file only with SEBI at this point.
Okay. I have a slightly different question now. We see that there's a regulation in LODR saying that agenda for advance notice for various decisions to be taken by the board has to be given to the exchange, like bonus, stock split, merger, acquisition, etc., etc. In real life situations, while agenda is circulated for taking the decision, it's quite possible that the decision is not taken in the board meeting or it is deferred, etc. Or sometimes board decision is taken, but it reverses in the next meeting. Is it possible, is it permitted under listing regulations that the item that is presented before the board is not considered or is reversed? Is it permitted or not permitted? Does the board have that kind of liberty to reverse its own decisions? Neeraj or Priya, whoever wants to take it. Neeraj, you are muted. You are muted, Neeraj. You are muted. Neeraj, you are muted. Neeraj, you are muted. You are muted, Neeraj.
Oh, sorry. No, no, by mistake, I pressed the button that I couldn't unmute myself.
Okay,
so,
yeah, that was the problem with me, and I've decided I'm not going to mute at all for the rest of the session.
Okay. Sure. No, so there's no bar on the reversal of business mentioned in the advance notice. So there is no bar in that sense, okay? The companies are required to be diligent in providing advance information, etc., and also factor in. However, there has to be proper disclosure and reasons for the same. That has to be also provided for investors in case, you know, one is reversing. And in case there is any investor grievance arising out of that, such redressal, that also has to be redressed. But there are certain instances, like things like bonus issues. It's very clearly, once these are declared, this is declared, then it cannot be reversed. So company has to explain the intent of making with respect to why this is done, etc., etc., and all those kind of things. And they will be open to a lot of questioning by us as exchanges also. So, but it, I mean, to answer, simply answer your question, whether there is a bar, no. There is no bar, except only with respect to the bonus.
Fine. I have a different question now. Either because of eagerness of press and TV channels to break news, or over enthusiasm of journalists, or even a simple competitive commercial tactic, the ongoings of a company or some corporate decisions of a company get leaked in the press in some form or the other. Sometimes company may be aware, company may not be aware, company may party, company may not be a party to it. How do you think this company should handle this? Because such leakages have got a lot of impact on the market prices, and maybe regulators look at it from a different perspective also. Priya, would like to take this question?
Sure. So the point is, this is frankly extremely tricky, and I think it's a very case-to-case assessment which each board has to make. But one thing which we will say, so there are a couple of things, right? One is, let's keep aside acquisitions for a minute, which needs to reach a certain level of certainty before the board can actually come out and make any statement. And unfortunately, acquisitions from a press perspective is of extreme interest. So they seem to break all sorts of news much ahead. But many of the other kind of disclosures, even if we reach a situation where, so let's assume for a minute that the press has broken it. I think it's important for the board and the management to consider how important or relevant that information is from a UPSI perspective, right? So if they believe that it is material enough to move the price, then I think it's important that even if they were not prepared to make the disclosure right away, just because of the fact that it has already come in public domain, it is important that they disclose. And the right way of disclosing is obviously to go through the exchanges, and therefore, you know, there are times exchanges, of course, do something called a rumor verification process. when there is something in the public domain already, generally disclosed by way of an overeager media or maybe even the other party, etc. But it is in public domain. We try and persuade the companies to disclose. This is not a one size fits all. So it might be extremely difficult to actually say list out all the circumstances in which this should happen. But I would really use the reasonable percent test. Accusations, again, certain level of certainty. But any other kind of information, I think it's better, even if the preparation has not been there, to disclose it today. If it is in the press, it's better to make a full disclosure. Because if the underlying price moves, and we must also remember the underlying price is not just cash market, right? Derivatives also move and move very differently. It's important for the company to actually come out and make that disclosure. There have been times, and anecdotally, even outside of India, where a certain transaction has not been able to go forward simply because of the fact that disclosures were made ahead. But that, frankly, is it's really you can't do anything. Listed, then there are certain obligations that you owe to the market, and you might not be able to do anything about it. That's my view.
Okay. My next question is for both the exchanges. Compliance is a lot of cost. All companies, secretary departments, compliance departments are frugally staffed, unlike your stock exchanges where you've got 60, 80 people in your departments. They are frugally staffed, and it's quite poor. They are hard pressed for time, a lot of demands on them, Companies Act, SEBI regulations, SEBI circulars, etc. What kind of assistance stock exchanges actually extend to this compliance department in terms of helping them to be compliant? After all, no company wants to be non-compliant, but it could be quietly a slip also. But do you think the stock exchanges extend any kind of support or help to these people in terms of being very compliant? It's a question to both the exchanges. What do you do in respective exchanges is a question. Neeraj?
What we have been doing, Neeraj, go first, please.
So first is, of course, we use technology extensively. So in that sense, what happens is the filing need not be physical in a lot of cases. Of course, where it has to be in terms of some kind of scanned copy, etc. But when I say technology, means the way it works is that the person logs in, there's an OTP framework with respect to the authorized people, with respect to their registered mobile, etc., etc. Over and above that, there is a very detailed compliance calendar which is provided by us. And then finally, of course, there are checklists, there are reminders which are sent. So I mean, from a facilitative perspective, there is, if anyone has a will to comply, I don't see any problem with respect to these aspects. At least, people will not, if someone does diligently logs in to what we call the listing center, they would be able to know immediately that, what are their pending compliances right then and there with respect and or including the dates, etc.
Your views on this?
So essentially, we are also, as Neeraj said, technology. So we last year we introduced a new front end, and in the front end, what we're trying to do is to put in as many questions as possible. Just like an income tax website, there's a question there. You don't have to actually go to the instructions at the end. So we're trying to do that, just going to that particular item will tell you what you need to fill and so on and so forth. But over and above that, there are three or four things we hold extensively. We have held something what we call as chorus calls, where 200 to 300 companies have dialed in. And we try and do that every time a new regulation is introduced. Just so that, there can be immediate, apart from face-to-face seminars that we do along with, sometimes with NIS and sometimes with Chambers of Commerce, etc. We've had ICSI Institute, etc., where we've been doing in person, at least if I remember right, pre-COVID, we've done almost 20 odd in person kind of seminars. We have been doing chorus calls where we've had anywhere between 200 to 300 participants. I think again in the last in 2019 we may have done about 12 or so. And we are always available, right? During the COVID time, just about everybody's mobile was available for people to call in. And 93%, when we say that 93% of the filings were done on time during a COVID situation, it just goes to show that people are accessible. So there is guidance which is given, you know, one-to-one. There is guidance available in the form of seminars. There's guidance in the form of FAQs. We actually call as and we send reminders. We do all of that. So at this point in time, I think it's important, and whether it is you know, in the institute, anybody else, if there is anything that you believe that the exchanges can do, and any company can come forward and give us more suggestions, if there is anything that you believe that exchanges can do, please let us know. We are, I think, both BSE and NSE would be very happy to go forward on this. If you believe that there's more training required, we are also trying to work with ICSI. So anything that you, so we are doing all of this, but if we believe that we have not covered it sufficiently enough, please feel free to make your suggestions. We will take that on board immediately. I just want to say one last thing around PIT, prohibition of insider dealing. So there is a methodology by which you can actually check, for example, for a compliance officer, if you want to check whether anybody is actually traded, you can come to the exchanges and check. We also provide that, you know, that is a service where you can come back and check. So for the compliance officers, peace of mind, that also we do. So, you know, there are a variety of things. I think perhaps some of this is not widely, you know, known enough, sufficiently well known, but we are happy to do more of this. We are happy to do anything more that you think is appropriate.
Is this compliance calendar available on digitally somewhere? Yes. Because the question from the audience, they wanted to know whether it is available digitally. How do they download it? If you can highlight that, please.
No, so what happened?
Neat. Sorry, Neeraj, you go ahead.
It's available on that application where, you know, for the listed companies it is available. But I'm sure, see, whatever is available there essentially is, when we see regulation X, this date, it has to be done within so many days, etc. Those are all very standard. And that's all very well prescribed. It's all there on our website also, but I just need to, I'm not very sure, because see, things may be company specific, so that's the reason. What we provide is in the company login, they do get their.
Now,
my colleague has just confirmed that the calendar is available on our front end, which we call NIPS. But equally, as Neeraj said, when a company logs in, there are a whole lot of reminders and letters and everything. So, you know, there's very little chance that a company might miss something, just the sheer number of reminders.
It's actually heartening to note that both the exchanges have actually on the login itself giving so much of reminder and so much of help and support to the compliance officers to comply. One question to both of you is, how do you think the board of directors can help improve the corporate governance and compliance culture in their companies? What is your suggestion to the board of directors?
Honestly, tone from the top is the most important. Therefore, you know, a policy of no tolerance for any kind of non-compliance, I think will do more than any other rule that we might come out with. If the board gives, if people working in the company feel that the board is not serious enough and a checkbox or tick box compliance will suffice, then no amount of regulations is going to, you know, change that reality. So just the fact that, again, boards know and understand that valuations, you can make substantial difference in your company's valuation. If the company is seen and recognized as a company that has a high level and standards of governance. Therefore, the way I would see it is that the simple tone and a policy of non-tolerance is what is the most important from a board's perspective.
Okay.
Echo the same sentiment, because naturally it's essentially, see, the board essentially are the gatekeepers for the company, and particularly with respect to the governance practices, and in that sense, any direction from them supports. For example, a simple thing like if ever there is one single penalty on any company, which I assume that, you know, would be certainly disclosed to the board. So in that itself should be sufficient for boards to understand. It is not like these penalties are just off the cuff. These are important issues. So I'm sure. So in that sense, you know, it's probably the boards giving importance to such matters are very, very, are the key.
Okay, there are some questions, little tricky. I don't know whether you can answer this question. The question that comes from audience, I'm talking the question from audience is that why should companies file separately with NSE and BSE? Why can't there be a single platform on which it can be filed? That's one question. And another question I have is that, again, coming from the audience, is compliance equal to governance or is governance different from compliance? I leave both the questions to you to answer.
Governance is very different from compliance. Governance is a much larger world than simple compliance. So as we were just saying that if the board emphasizes on governance, then clearly compliance will happen by itself is my view. I don't think then anybody, and if there is a particular situation where something has not been fined or anything, that will be more a technical error than anything else. I think governance is critical. Why BSE and NSE have, these are two different exchanges. You're listed on two different exchanges. But to make people's life easier, I think what we have, what SEBI has introduced and what, I must also thank BSE there because XBRL, a lot of work was done by BSE and then NSE worked on the back of that. So a lot of the filings today are XBRL. We have tried to coordinate, we have coordinated substantially to make sure that whatever is filed at BSE or whatever is filed at NSE, you can just, download the XML file and upload in the other exchange. But fact is, these are two different platforms on which companies are listed. So I think that is pretty much it. But we will try and do what we can to make the filings easier. So therefore, as I said, XBRL is available for a whole bunch of filings. So there are not that many filings left where you have to actually key in and enter information in two different platforms. We will continue to make that easy. That's what I can say.
Neeraj, your views?
No, so I echo exactly the same views because, see, with respect to governance is certainly a much, much wider topic. I'll just go to the genesis just briefly. I mean, all these guidelines, finally, they have been driven from the Kotak committee report. All these recent changes, in fact, that's what I'll talk about. And the underlying theme was governance in that. So whether things like, composition of the boards that we are talking about, or what should be the kind of disclosures and transparency or accounting audit, or in terms of monitoring of group entities or related parties. And I missed the major point, which is about the institution of independent directors and investor parties. These essentially all of them comprise what is the minimum governance standards, and then compliance at the end is certain amount of filings that we would have, and which we may or may not have captured almost every possible thing there, but largely we have tried to capture most of the ethos there. On the other point, as Priya said, is about filing. So because there are two separate venues where the company is listed and where trading is taking place independently, so we have done the next best thing, which is our formats being XBRL is a global format, is a standard format. So whatever one files here can easily be filed there or vice versa. So to that extent, it's just that, yeah, there is a need to file twice, but the format is similar. So in that sense, okay. We have removed all those, unnecessary stuff from that. So to ease life for profit.
Okay. The question that comes up is that, yes, companies that are resourceful will have their team of compliance officers, etc. But whereas smaller companies, which are less resourceful, they are actually filed or listed on your SME platform, whether the rigors of compliances and corporate governance are the same as we have in the main platform, or is there a difference?
There is a slight amount of difference, especially for a corporate governance report. See, it's not so much difference from a format perspective. It is just a little different from, something is quarterly, something is half yearly, etc. But I have a strong view on this, and I've had this view for many years. The point is big companies are covered by analysts, are covered by various people. So the information that's available in the public domain is much, much more. Smaller companies don't have that level of information. So exchange filing is perhaps one of the few ways in which they can actually showcase themselves also. And therefore, you know, to if you ask my view on whether or not that level of disclosure should be there for an SME company also, I would say yes, absolutely. The way that a company, a smaller company, will become a larger company, will come to the attention of investors, etc., is also by putting out more information about itself. And therefore, you know, I don't think there needs to be a differentiation. What perhaps exchanges can do is to actually handhold a lot, you know, more if that is the requirement and if that's the ask. Certainly something which we can definitely work on. But so therefore, answering your question in two parts, there are certain very small differences, not so much in content as much as, you know, frequency. But secondly, I do believe that it is important that SMEs, you know, there is also a pathway for SMEs to migrate to the main board. It's important that there's that level of preparedness also. So, you know, that would be my response.
I just read out certain suggestions that have come from the audience. If you have any responses to that, you may. Otherwise, I just would read out. One view was that as per, in my view, that is the participant's view, compliance is a directive to maintain relationship with business in sustainable way by human beings. That was the view. And then compliance also includes switching off. Sorry.
Somebody spoke about switching off the video.
Yeah, correct. Corporate governance is an offshoot of broader governance, and compliance is one of the technical aspects of corporate governance. Can we fairly claim the companies are akin to corporate governance? I think Priya has already answered this question. The other question is, a circular is issued to holding virtual AGMs until 31/12/21. Is it applicable to board also is a question. My personal view is this, board of the Companies Act has already allowed on a perennial basis that board meeting can be held on a VC basis. Therefore, this circular is not relevant to board meetings as such. And then, is there a list published by SEBI which ranks companies based on completeness, timing, and other parameters? BSE, you have any view on this? Is there any list published by you or anybody in terms of?
No, I missed that list published for what?
For ranking, compliance ranking or governance ranking?
So, no. So see, what happened is we don't do that because for us, it will be, we don't get into, we are venues where companies get listed. Okay, for us, all companies have to comply. All companies have to comply. And so we will not be ranking them. But yeah, there are private initiatives which do take place. Which is from a point of view of improved standards of governance, etc. But you know, such private initiatives, what they do is they will not cover the full universe.
That's right.
So they cover only investable universe or a limited part of the investable universe. So then eventually, see, we know that, you know, there have been top 50 rankings, etc., that have been done, but it's a very small universe, you know, considering around 4,800 odd listed companies which are there on the exchange. Yeah. That's a very small universe.
Yeah, Priya, you have your views?
See, at this time, we don't rank. The issue, frankly, would be that if we rank, then what is the end to which we rank? So there has to be an end game to this, right? Just for the purpose of ranking, you would not rank the companies, makes no sense to me. But potentially, the idea that if we do rank companies, then, and if we say that somebody is more compliant than somebody else, then potentially the answer has to then be that they make less number of disclosures. Or, you know, if there is one technical default, then you don't hit them with a penalty. There has to be some meaning to this, right? I mean, you would not rank in isolation. So at right. this point in time, we don't rank. Whether it's a conversation worth having, my view is yes. And again, it's only a personal view, not that of NSE. It's okay. Definitely a conversation worth having, but yeah. we are not down that road yet.
Yeah. I just have one more point to add in this. See, what happens is as exchanges, no, there is a conflict issue also for us. See, we are also, you know, we are venues where companies are listed and we have to ensure total compliance with respect to that. So, therefore, ranking companies, etc., is certainly, I mean, finally, the public ranks them and public punishes the companies or rewards companies in terms of purchasing or prices, etc. But our role I mean, again, this is probably philosophical, but our role is more from a point of view of ensuring adequate disclosures and information for and removing the information asymmetry. That's the reality.
I just have one more 30 seconds to add. So I think BSE also does that and NSE also does this. We don't give ranks to companies, so we don't necessarily say X is ranked 1 and 2, but there are broader reports that we come out with. So when we say that we looked at 500 companies and we ended up finding that X number of companies were compliant, and these are the metrics we used, etc. So we came up with a report last year on ESG, where we ended up finding when we looked at 50 companies, we didn't look at, for example, banking companies or IT, because from an environmental perspective, they would score very high despite the fact that they don't have a lot of environmental concerns. But be that as it may, so we ended up finding that many of the companies did score high on governance. But the broader point being that we, through our reports, which don't rank companies specifically, but we at least give some indication of where companies are, so companies could actually use those reports in a way to structure themselves and get, and make themselves improve themselves. It's really that simple.
There's one interesting question from one of the audiences, is that can we standardize the dates in terms of 7 days, 14 days, 21 days for different events, rather than having dispersed date for somewhere we've got 11 days, somewhere we've got 3 days, etc. Can they be standardized is a question. I believe the answer will be it requires amendment to the regulation, and therefore it can be at best taken as a suggestion. It's about 5:45 now. I think I need to wind up. I recognize that there are Mr. Vasudeva, Mr. Luthra, etc., and several other learned people on the participants. I am technically unable to call them in to give their views in the matter because I don't have the controls on making you unmute and all, sir. Good evening, and we are very happy that we could make a discussion in your presence. And hopefully, you would circulate your new views amongst the group who have participated here. On behalf of NISM and on behalf of IICA, I thank Mr. Neeraj and Ms. Priya for participating in this panel discussion. I thank each one of you for having participated in this program and participate in this program and make this program successful. Dr. Tara Shankar, I'll hand it over back to you for your remarks.
Thank you, sir. I, on behalf of IAC and the entire team of Center for Independent Directors, extend my thanks to Dr. Narasimhan Saab for sparing his valuable time and accepting my request to be the moderator for this today's session. And you have handled this moderation so nicely. And I would further like to thank Ms. Priya Madam and Neeraji for such an insightful, power-packed discussion. And it was quite informative. And I'm sure that our audience are definitely going to help these, whatever the discussion they have taken out of it, and the kind of knowledge that they have gained and the insightful informations were there. So even I could see some amazing discussions that actually was very interesting and very informative. So I thank all the audience and from IICA, and I'm sure that this is going to help in terms of implementing it in their profession. Thank you so much. And we will keep on coming with such events further, and that will definitely going to help. Thank you so much, and have a happy weekend. Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you. Thanks to all the participants. Thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you. It was a pleasure.